Ladies and gentlemen, good evening to all of you. It is really my privilege to welcome such distinguished gathering for the today's program. In fact, they had been the pillars of our long series of taxation, be it accounting, be it auditing, be it law, be it spiritual programs. I extend my hearty welcome to all of you. On behalf of the CMA Rajni Chawla, who is also the director of Northern India Chartered Accountants Association and associate of Raj Chawla and Co. LLP, Sunil Garbji, who is a distinguished expert on G-Business, on the tax matters, and also a partner of Raj Chawla LLP and Co., Aseem Chawla ji, a CA and an advocate, and he has been closely associated with this direct tax code, decoding of the direct tax code. Our knowledge partner, Himanshu ji, from Tax for Wealth. In fact, the list can go on long, but I extend my hearty welcome to all the members who are present in this auditorium. The all participants who have been actually joining us with so many last programs, it has been a privilege to talk to all of you. So I extend my hearty welcome to all of you. Today, we have assembled here to celebrate, to enjoy, to express our delight and express our gratitude to all those individual subject experts who in fact made this program a great success. I think during the pandemic, we who belong to this organization and have been part of this organizing process are really delighted that during the pandemic, this organization, that is Northern India Chartered Accountants Association, kept the flag flying high as far as professional knowledge and enrichment is concerned. It is towards that journey that we have organized series of webinars, and let's remember that it is not the technical subjects. In view of the great pandemic, we also organized the program on spiritual aspects, yoga and meditation. Having regard to this particular fact, now this program is divided in three parts. The first part shall deal with the, in a way, where we are trying to conclude the webathon series on decoding of the income tax law. It has been a great initiative. Great speakers are involved, and I think it has been truly, completion of the Income Tax Act in the truest sense. In the second leg of the program, we wish to release, or I'll say we wish to actually organize, I wish to look at the a review of the very celebrated book, which has been recently published by our dear esteemed member, CA Aseem Chawla. The title of the book itself is very interesting, which we'll deal in the second session. It deals with the title of the book is Finding a Straight Line Between Twists and a Turn. It's still the title runs, Imperfect, Yet Honest, and Reflection on the Indian Tax Landscape. Title itself is pretty long. So we'll actually closely look at this book. And I feel very excited to look at this particular book because the title itself does not convey any topic. So all professionals, whether they are in the direct taxes area, whether they're in the indirect taxes area, whether they're in international taxation, I think it covers a myriad of topics as far as this book is concerned. So in the second session, we'll have a review of this book so that our members can be benefited. And let me tell you that subsequently, as we are in fact doing a Samapan Samaro, of the decoding of the income tax law, we shall continue with the international taxation series. And finally, at the end, we shall be having our felicitation ceremony. That is the real one of the purpose which for which we have assembled here today. In fact, without these subject experts, all this imparting of education would not have been possible. So we have come here, flocked together to express our gratitude to all our subject experts. Thank you. Thank you very much. Now I'll request Sunil ji to take over for the part one of the program, that is the last ultimate part, which shall be delivered by another subject expert, C.S. Sunil Arora ji. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Kapoor sir. So friends, this is like a dream coming true. And this is the concluding program of our Webathon series on decoding income tax law. Friends, we started this journey on 16th June, as you know, and we planned 40 webinars, and this is day 33. So first of all, I welcome Sri Sunil Arora ji, who is the guest speaker today, to conclude this Webathon series. I also welcome Shri Rajesh Agrawal ji. Please come on the dais. He is the guest of honor today, please. And we will be joining by Dr. Girish Ahuja ji, and he will be giving blessings to us. Friends, when we think of this idea, frankly speaking, we were not sure even that how far we can go, how the journey will go ahead. But this idea was certainly mooted by our mentor, Shri Raj Chawla ji. Then we have this idea to our senior most partner, Shri I.P. Bansal ji and Asim Chawla ji. And then we constituted a team. Five of us think about it, churned the idea, and then started the things on 16 June. And friends, it's a lifetime experience, at least for me, because I got the privilege to be the moderator of the whole Webathon series, the whole 33 webinars, I being the moderator. So I learned a lot about to study, how to study income tax law. And during this journey, we come across a number of speakers, a learned speakers. And I here welcome in this physical seminar, Shri Bhupinderjeet ji, who is here, Shri R.D. Sharma ji, Shri Baldev Raj ji, who is also here. So friends, as narrated by Shri Vijay Kapoor ji, first we will be having the concluding webinar on section 285 to 298. And then we will have the review of book written by Shri Asim Chawla ji. And in the last, as a gratitude to our speakers, learned speakers, our session chairman, and our guest of honors during this journey, we will felicitate them. And I also request Shri Asim Chawla ji, who is the session chairman, please come on the dais.
Respected seniors present here on the dais and off the dais, my very beloved, in fact, we have two Sunils here, Sunil Garg Saab and Mr. Arora, who have done exceedingly well in espousing the cause of today's conclusion, or an interim conclusion, because seven more sessions are still there in place. I am glad that I could prevail upon Mr. Arora to take this session up. And to me, these are very important provisions. The segment which we are dealing today is very important, because many practitioners are aware that things like 26AS, things like 292, CBCR reporting, etc., they all are subsumed in this particular provisions, including the specified financial transactions and Rule 114. So without much ado, I would request Arora Saab to take this further. We have a couple of hours with us, and I think we will make the most of it. But suffice to say that without the encouragement of Mr. Chawla and Garg Saab, we would not have seen this. But for the moment, I'll keep it short. Main apni vaani ko viram deta hun, and over to you, Sunil ji.
I was trying to decode the entire gamut of the sections which is there between 285 and 298. So I could broadly classify them into these categories. I'm not going section wise, but I'm trying to take it group wise. Now, there are some sections whereby powers are being delegated to central government for certain acts. Central government has been empowered as per the act. Now, I'll just quickly run through those provisions because there are a lot, 30 sections we need to cover, and probably we have only 30 minutes. Wherein I think 285 BA, probably I was told that we need to cover more exhaustively. So I'll just quickly run through these provisions. Now we have 291, which empowers central government to grant immunity from prosecution and penalty in case the central government feels that somebody is evidence is required for coming out the full true and facts of some concealment of income. Then the central government can give immunity to some person for taking evidence or for taking his information from him and to ensure that he is not prosecuted as per his own statement also. So that is where 291 has empowered central government to take this particular call. Then we have 293A. Now in 293A, specific powers have been given to central government that for exploration of mineral oil, in case any specific benefits have to be given to any company which comes for mineral oil exploration, the central government can give specific immunity to them, specific exemptions to them. 293B talks of a lot of approvals have to be taken from central government. Now, if there is any delay in submission for those approvals, then continuation of delay can be made by the central government. 293B empowers central government to condone those delays. There was no provision for withdrawing the withdrawal of approvals. So what has happened is that 293C was inserted in the enactment to give power to the central government to withdraw any approvals if at all it has been given. Then 293D was recently brought in that you can have approvals, you can apply for, or registrations you can apply in a faceless manner through e-filing. As regards 294A, exemption, if at all, needs to be given to certain union territories because of union territories like Pondicherry, Goa, all these union territories. At the time of secession from France, there were some agreements with them. So to honor those agreements, 294A empowers central government to give benefits to these union territories. And 295, of course, is for power to make rules. Now, all these rules have been made as per this power, which is contained in section 295. And then 298, the last section, empowers central government to issue notifications for removing any difficulties, if at all, which are being faced in implementation of the Income Tax Act. Now, this is the overview of the sections which are there where this powers have been given to central government. There are two sections wherein the information with the department can be shared. Now, 285BB, the central government has been given power that the information which they have collected as per that annual information reports, the annual information statement pertaining to that particular SSC can be posted on the portal of the Income Tax Department. So this is specifically the power has been given to central government to put this information pertaining to the SSC in his portal. 287 is a very peculiar power which has been given for sharing of information. I'm sure lately there was a lot of talk about income tax searches being conducted on Sonu Sood. And you find that the department comes up with the information that we have collected information regarding concealed income of 17 crores and 20 crores was unaccounted and all those things. And this kind of information, the department has been sharing quite frequently about a lot of other searches or a lot of other SSCs also. Now, the question is that this pertaining to one particular SSC, this is a confidential information. Now, should the government be allowed to share this information on a selective basis, whatever they want to share? Now, this power has been given to the central government under this section 287. that if at all pertaining to any specific SSC, any specific information with respect to that SSC, if the central government wants to share or bring it in public domain, then they can bring it as per that, as per Section 287. Now, as far as appearance is concerned, authorized representatives, the details are in Section 288. A registered valuer can appear in 287A before the income tax authorities. We have some miscellaneous sections, rounding off of income to the nearest multiple of 10, rounding off of tax also to the nearest multiple of 10. Now, there are some small sections, receipts to be given in 289, that every payment there has to be, receipt has to be given. Then we have cognizance of offenses in 292, non-application of 360 of criminal procedure code is provided in section 292A. Now 292 provides that no court less than the first class judicial magistrate would take cognizance of any offenses under the Income Tax Act. Now 293 provides, it prohibits any action in civil courts against the departmental officials for carrying out their duties, one. And second thing is that it bars the action which has been taken. The civil courts have been barred for the SSCs also to approach for any relief against the proceedings which are going on under the Income Tax Act. And 297 is repeals and savings. That means when 1922 Act was repealed, those are the provisions contained in 297. This was just an overview. Now we come to some of the sections which would need a discussion or a little in-depth discussion would be required. We have 292B. Now 292B provides that if there is any mistake in the income tax return or the assessment order or notice, then just because the mistake is there in that particular notice, the entire order or entire notice or return will not be treated as invalid. This is what Section 292B provides. A more significant section is 292BB. Now, 292BB brings in a deeming fiction that a notice will be deemed to be valid. We'll be discussing it at length after this. Then we have four more sections which are bringing in certain presumptions here. We have 292C, which says that during the search, if any assets or books of accounts would be are seized or found, then there will be a presumption that the books of accounts and the assets belong to the SSC whose premises have been searched. Where those books of accounts have been found, there will be a presumption that the SSC has maintained all those books of accounts and he has signed all those books of accounts. They are duly signed and he cannot take a plea that they do not belong to me. Although this plea is taken a number of times, but then the onus is on the SSC to show that the presumption here contained in this section 292C is rebuttable, but he has to rebut this particular presumption which is provided under section 292C. Similarly, section 292CC also brings in a clarification here. If the authorization for search has been issued and the authorization for search contains multiple names, that means let's suppose a search of a family is taking place and what is done is the authorization is issued in the name of all the family members, or let's suppose a partnership firm or premises of a partnership firm is being searched and in the personal name of all the partners an authorization is issued. So the issue which came was that whether this authorization is valid only in the case of a family together, or is it valid individually for all the names which are there in that particular authorization of search which is there. So 292CC primarily clarified that the authorization, even if individual names are mentioned together in one authorization, then also that does not mean that the authorization is only to the extent of their collective involvement in something. Their individual, that means each of them individually is also covered by the authorization, and the assessments can also be made individually in their cases. This is what section 292CC provided. 294 provided for an eventuality that if Finance Act is not passed, that what rates would be applicable. And here it says that the previous Finance Act, the rates which were there in the previous Finance Act would apply, or the if the Finance Act bill is there in the Parliament, then whichever is more beneficial to the SSC can be adopted by the SSC. This is only an eventuality which possibly
does not arise in most of the cases. It has never arisen as far as our country is concerned. Then we have 296. Now it provides that rules and notifications which are issued by the central government or by the CBDT will have to be placed before parliament within a stipulated time. And 296 provides for that. Now we have talked about rest all the provisions. 292 double B needs a little consideration. Let's have a situation that the SSC appears before assessing officer during some assessment or reassessment proceedings. The assessment is made against him. Subsequently, he goes to a lawyer, and the lawyer, after looking at the facts of the case, realizes that the notice was not properly served, or it was not served at all, or there was, as far as the service of notice, it was not within the time provided under the law. So subsequently, the appellate, this plea is taken before the appellate authority that the notice was either not served on the SSC, or it was not served in time, or it was not served as provided in the law. So as a result, what happens is the entire proceedings or orders were quashed by the appellate authority. Now, to overcome this situation, Section 292 double B was introduced by Finance Act 2008. Now, this says that if during assessment or reassessment proceedings, the SSC has appeared before the assessing officer or has cooperated during the such proceedings, the inquiry during such proceedings, then subsequently he cannot take a plea that he was not served with the notice or notice was not properly served. So there was a deeming fiction they have introduced that once you are appearing, once you are cooperating with the assessing officer, then the service of notice will not be deemed to be as per law, and any defect regarding service will not be raised. Now, further, the section provides that in case the SSC objects during the assessment proceedings itself, before the completion of the assessment proceedings, that the notice has not been served, or it is not served within time, or it has not been served appropriately, then in that event, the presumption which is there in Section 292 double B would not apply. So this is a presumptive section. Now, most of the time, the department takes a plea regarding 292 double B for any kind of non-compliance of the statutory provisions which are there. Say, for example, if a notice under Section 143(2) has not been issued, so in such a situation, can the department take a plea that once the SSC has cooperated during the assessment proceedings, then 292 double B should get attracted, and the SSC cannot take a plea that 143. Now, this issue came up before Supreme Court in the case of Lakshman Das Khandelwal, and Honorable Supreme Court had the occasion to examine this. The apex court of the country held that the presumption under Section 292 double B is with respect to only service of the notice and not with respect to issue of notice. So in case a notice under Section 148 or 143(2) has not been issued, and even if the SSC has appeared before the assessing officer and he has not even raised objection during the assessment proceedings, even then this would be fatal to the entire proceedings, and the entire proceedings are subject to be quashed, and 292 double B will not help the department in that situation. Now, this was briefly 292 double B. Now, the next set of sections which are there, which are comprised in 285 to 298, is the compliance provisions which are there. Now, we have Section 285, which provides for compliance in the case of a liaison office. Then we have 285A, wherein the shares are deriving their value on the basis of assets held in India. So in those cases, what is the kind of reporting which is there? Then we have 285B with respect to cinematographic films. 285BA is, of course, I think the most probably section where a lot of queries, a lot of issues should be there. And then we have 286, a report in respect of international group. Now, we'll briefly discuss 285, 285A, 285B, and 285BA. As far as 286 is concerned, if any entity in India belongs to an international group, then a report has to be sent to the department by such Indian entity giving information about the international group. I'm not going into the details of this because this has a very limited application. This section 286 applies, subsection 7 of 286 provides that only in case the gross turnover of the group is more than rupees 5,500 crores, only then this section 286 would be retracted. So it has a limited application, so I'm not going into the details of that. But we'll briefly discuss 285, 285A and B and BA. Now, as far as a liaison office is concerned, a liaison office is not expected or is not meant for carrying out any commercial activity in India. So a liaison office cannot file its income tax return because it does not have income. A liaison office does not generate any income. So it does not have, it does not create any income. So as a result, no income tax return needs to be filed by a liaison office. But to ensure that the department gets information about the working of the liaison office, Section 285 provides that every liaison office in India shall file a statement in form number 49C within 60 days from the end of the financial year. This information would be filed. There is rule 114DA for that, and the information has to be furnished in the electronic form along with DSC. The statement 49C basically contains information regarding the liaison office, and this is a basic, because in liaison office what happens is the money is received from the parent company and only the expenses are incurred in the liaison office. So that information plus details of the activity which has been carried out, all those information is to be given in this 49C. Then we have 285A. Now 285A, the background of 285A was the Vodafone case. Now what had happened there was that shares were being transferred by a Mauritius company which was holding shares of another Mauritius company. That even the second company was not holding shares in India. So there was a three-tier kind of a structure. So we have company A, which was holding shares in company B, and company B was holding shares in Vodafone. Both A and B were outside India. Shares of A were getting transferred, and that also to an entity outside India. So there, of course, the issue came that the value of those shares was based on the assets which were held by Vodafone in India. So in other words, the value of those shares, they were deriving its value from assets which were in India. And ultimately, the amendments were made, although retrospective were made at that point of time, which is now being rectified. So what has happened is that those shares, when A was transferring shares to company Z, the capital gains for those shares, the government wanted to tax it in India. Now this 285A is an enabling provision whereby the information with respect to such companies which are indirectly holding shares of Indian companies and deriving value on the basis of the assets which are held in India, that information has to be given to the department. And this information has to be given within 90 days of the end of the financial year in form number 49D as per rule 114DB. And there are penal provisions also in case this information is not given by the Indian entity to the income tax department. 285B is a very small provision. Now 285B primarily provides that a producer of a cinematographic film has to, within 30 days of the financial year, end of the financial year, or on completion of his production, he has to furnish a statement in form number 52A and to contain details about all payments exceeding 50,000 rupees in aggregate made to any person who was engaged in production of that particular film. whether as an employee or otherwise. So the idea was to have the information regarding production of the film immediately from the producer. So 285B was introduced. So it's a very small section. So now the 298, section 285 to 298 primarily provided for all these compliances. We have left out just 285BA, that is the SFT, wherein the SFT is required. Now I'll quickly run through the presentation on this, and then we have Sunil Gargji. He'll be discussing the issues on this. Now, as far as 285BA is concerned, this is the last section which I'm addressing in this 285 to 298.
Yeah, go ahead.
Anything you'd like to share? Or we are just moving to 285BA. Yeah. So if there's any issue you would like to comment upon of the sections.
I think we are all, in the interest of time, this, let's try and complete.
Okay, so now 285BA, one thing which I always say is that as far as tax statutes and especially income tax in our country, this not just imposes tax on me, this imposes a lot of other responsibilities also on me. And those responsibilities are TDS. Now, what is TDS basically? I'm acting as government's agent, or I'm acting as agent of the income tax department to collect tax on their behalf. And if I fail to do it, or if I commit a mistake there, I'm penalized, I'm prosecuted. I'm supposed to collect information, collect tax. TDS is one, then TCS is another one. There also the same thing applies. Now 285BA goes beyond that and makes me an informer. So 285BA basically, I become an informer of the department, wherein I have to share some information with the department, and department basically translates this information into the annual information report and annual information statement, which is used for necessary, action against the SSC or comparing with his the returns which he is filing. Now, the scope of this particular section has been lately widened quite a lot. Now, the entire gamut is contained in section 285BA. We have rule 114E to 114H, and then we have form number 61A and 61B. Now, we have penal provisions here, and the penal provisions are contained in section 271FA.
Yep.
We have wherein it provides a penalty of 500 rupees per day in case I delay in filing my SFT by the due date. There's a penalty of 500 rupees per day. Then we have 271FA further provides that in case I fail to follow the directions given under section 5, subsection 5, then there's a penalty. Instead of 500, it is 1000 rupees per day. And in case I furnish an inaccurate statement, then the penalty can go up to 50,000 rupees. Now, section 285BA primarily gives the basic framework of collecting information from various sources for the department and casts the onus upon the SSC to provide that particular information. Now, what it provides is basically is that some specified transactions, there is a legal obligation to furnish that information to the department. There are in all 11 entities who have to report these transactions under this 285BA. Now, what are the specified financial transactions? They have been defined in subsection 3 of section 285BA. If the statement is defective, then the department can give me an opportunity to correct that defect. And in case it is still not corrected, then the necessary action against me can be taken for furnishing an inaccurate information. Subsection 5 provides that a notice can be issued for furnishing the statement. And in case of inaccurate information, then what how that can be corrected, this is provided in 6. And 7, subsection 7 provides that central government can make rules with respect to this 285BA. Now, when we look at the 11 kinds of entities who are under an obligation to share the information, this practically they have covered, tried to cover all those entities which are dealing with finance or money in any form. They have tried to cover every kind of such entity. Of course, all SSCs are specified as the very first category. Then we have rest of most of it. When you look at it, you will find that all entities which have anything to do with any kind of finance or money or anything, all those entities they have tried to cover in this. Now, Section 285BA covers all kinds of SSCs, but 114E2, read along with the table which is there, restricts the application of 285BA. What I am trying to say here is that 285BA talks of all SSCs, whereas all SSCs are not necessarily reporting persons when we come to the rule. So if you look at it this manner, that enabling provision in 285BA, all SSCs, the government can make rules, but the rules which have been made up till now restricts it only to some category of SSCs who are under an obligation to give a report of the specified financial transactions. So that means reporting entities now get divided into two categories, one who have to report and one who although 285BA provides, but need not report right now because there is no rule for that. And the entities which are under an obligation to report is, first of all, any person who is liable for tax audit under Section 44AB. So majority of business entities get covered by this particular provision of SFT. That means statement specified financial transactions.
Statement of financial transactions.
Yeah,
go ahead.
Now, a company which is issuing shares, a company which is issuing bonds or debentures, a listed company if it is doing buyback of shares, and any NBFC holding a certificate for accepting deposits from the public, an authorized dealer of foreign exchange of securities or FEMA, any banking company, cooperative bank, postmaster general, companies or institution issuing credit cards, trustee of a mutual fund, registrar, sub-registrar, inspector general, all these are categories of entities which are covered both by 285BA as well as 114E. That means all those entities become reporting persons and they are under an obligation to file the information statement of financial transactions, specified financial transactions which are there. They are under an obligation to file those SFTs. As far as the person under who's liable for audit under section, but then we have, if you look at the table which is there in 114E, this table, rule 114E, this provides for reportable persons and the kind of report which they have to give. That means it is not common. It is not that all entities have to give the same report. So different kind of specified financial transactions have to be reported by different persons who are the reporting entities. Now, as far as a tax audit is concerned, the primary report which is there from every concern which is under tax audit is that if they have received any cash payment exceeding rupees 2 lakhs for sale of goods and services, then they are under an obligation to report that. Now, the thing to be noted here is the cap is per transaction and not aggregate during the year. That means if you are making sales of say 1 lakh and you made it 10 times during the year to a concerned person and you have received 10 lakh rupees cash from him, you need not report. But the moment the transaction is about 2 lakh rupees, then the person who's selling the goods becomes a reporting person and he's under an obligation to report that. Moreover, if the company is issuing shares, in the case of a company which is issuing shares, then receipt of 10 lakh rupees or more for acquiring shares is the company is under an obligation to report this transaction in the statement of financial transactions. Now here, please remember, in the case of a tax audit, the amount which was there, 2 lakhs, This was only with respect to cash transactions. That means if you have received cash exceeding rupees 2 lakhs from any person for any transaction or for any event, in that particular case, you are supposed to report that. On the contrary, in the case of a company, even if this 10 lakh rupees has been received through banking channels, even in such a situation, it has to be reported. Now, the another question which arises here is, there can be a time gap between receiving the amount and issuing of shares. So, is the report to be given when the sum is received or when the shares are issued? So, to my mind, the receiving of the amount is important. And whenever this amount is received as share application money also, even in that situation, the necessary information has to be filed in SFT. If a company is issuing bonds or debentures and they have received exceeding rupees 10 lakh from any person, then this information has to be there in that statement of financial transactions, which has to be filed by the SSC or by the company in such a situation. If a listed company is carrying out any buyback of shares, then if the buyback of shares from one person is exceeding to more than rupees 10 lakhs, then in such a situation, the listed company is under an obligation to report this buyback to the to include this in the as a specified financial transaction, which has to be reported in the statement, which is to be filed under section 285BA. Similarly, a person who's dealing in foreign exchange, a dealer of a foreign exchange, has to report in case he has had any transaction of exceeding rupees 10 lakh from any person during any year, then he is under an obligation to report that in this under 285BA. Now, this includes not just cash, exchange of cash, foreign currency, but even traveler's check, forex cards. So any kind of receipt exceeding rupees 10 lakh by the foreign exchange of dealer has to be reported. A registrar or a sub-registrar, wherein the transactions with respect to properties have to be registered, he is under an obligation to report purchase or sale of immovable property having stamp duty value or which is valued at exceeding rupees 30 lakhs has to be reported by registrar or sub-registrar. Similarly, mutual fund also the cap is 10 lakhs. So if the mutual fund has received more than 10 lakh rupees from any person, then they are under an obligation to report this. Similarly, there are obligations on a banking company also. And every bank is under an obligation that in case there is any cash payment of draft exceeding rupees 10 lakhs, aggregating to more than 10 lakh rupees in a year, then the report has to be given. If a cash deposit or withdrawal of more than 50 lakh rupees in one or more current account is there aggregating to more than 50 lakh rupees, then this is to be reported. If there is a cash deposit of more than 10 lakh rupees in any other account other than a current account, then also the report has to be given. And similarly, for a time deposit aggregating to more than 10 lakh rupees, the information has to be given. And for credit card payments, more than 1 lakh in cash or more than 10 lakhs by any other mode also has to form a part of the statement of financial transactions which has to be filed. In addition thereto, the banking company was also supposed to report during that demonetization period the cash which was deposited. Now this obviously does not have any relevance now. Now, the issue is how do we comply with these provisions? 285BA talks of an SSC. Now, whether all SSCs are covered or now, as I've said initially, to my mind, 285BA talks of an SSC, but all SSCs are not covered by this. So we have 114E, which provides for reporting persons. So only the reporting persons have to report. And there we have a company which is issuing shares, a listed company which is doing buyback of shares, a company which is issuing bonds and debentures. These are all reporting persons and they are under an obligation to report. Then we have a person who's liable for tax audit under section 44AB, an NBFC which is accepting deposits and authorized money changers are the reporting persons who are under an obligation to file the SFT. Now, another issue which arises is, if there is no reportable transaction, then what do we do? And in case any notice is received, then how do we respond to that? So my take on this is that although 285 BA provides for all assessees as the reporting persons, but then read with the rule 114E, to my mind, the entities which are not covered in the table under rule 114E are not reportable persons because they are not fulfilling the stipulations which are contained in the rule, and other SSEs who are not covered by rule 114E need not comply. And then we have, once a person becomes a reporting person, once he is a reporting person, if he has a reportable transaction, obviously he has to file that statement. What happens in case he has no transaction to report? So here also, I think a preliminary response has to be filed. And that preliminary response which is there is wherein it can be specified that you have no reporting transaction or it is not applicable. There can be situations where a particular reporting person has multiple reporting. It can be a situation that he is becoming a reporting entity or reporting person because it is under an obligation for audit under Section 44AB, as well as it has issued shares. So because of both these conditions, he becomes a reportable person. In that event, he'll have to report for both the transactions. So he'll be under an obligation to report both the transactions. Now, I would like to request Mr. Sunil Garg to please share his view on this 285 BA, the practical and certain issues which arise in 285 BA. So I'll be, we have expert who has done a lot of work on this. So over to Mr. Sunil Garg.
So friends, this is the concluding webinar of this webathon series on decoding of income tax law. But this is not the end of the journey. Rather, we are starting a new journey from 25th of this month, from Saturday, and it will be on the international taxation. 7 webinar series will be done in a row. The whole coverage of income, international taxation, DTA, MLI, transfer pricing, and we will be having a special session on interpretation of statute. And this program has been devised by none other than Sri Asim Chawraji, and it will be done under his guidance. And now I formally thank Sri Sunil Arora-ji, our guest speaker today, for today's deliberation. Over to Sri Vijay.
Good evening, friends. Before I begin, I think this is one of the highly invigorating section where we are going to actually have a book review, which is very, very important for the professionals. May I now request to the publisher of this book, who has actually knows each and every word of this book, Mr. Sanjay Sethi?
Yes.
May I request him to come up on the dais? Since CMG has been discussing day in and day out some of the things with me, I'm highly excited about the book. In fact, as I share the title of the book, it takes few minutes. Why such a title, sir?
Yeah.
Why such a title? Finding straight line between twists and turns. The title does not end there. Finding straight line between twists and the turn. Frankly speaking, when I looked at the title, sir, I was reminded of my journey, road journey to the mountain, you know.
Right.
Okay. But the title does not end there. It says, imperfect, yet honest reflection of the Indian tax landscape. Now my heart beating started, you know. The gentleman is not talking of one system of taxation in India. He is going to look at the entire comprehensive gamut, Indian tax landscape. This is very crucial, you know. So it's very, very important thing. So I'm very happy that CMG did request me to have a look at this. So some of the topics, which I will read out a complete list little later, he also deals with the capital gains, Sunilji. He also deals with the transfer pricing. He also deals with the angularities of the present GST system. He also deals with the money laundering, etc. So I'm sure that given the topics which he has covered and the way he has dealt with the judicial pronouncements, and in fact the gentleman is trying to look at that what is going to happen 10 years down the lane, you know, 2031. So he has got a lot of visionary approach to the Indian fiscal legislation. So friends, I think there was a technical snag in between. So I think we're trying to visualize the title of the book, which itself is very, very exciting. I shall repeat the title again. I love it reading it again and again, Asimji.
Thank you.
Because finding the straight line between twists and turns, imperfect, yet honest, reflection of the Indian tax landscape, you know. So I made a point, the title, the last subtitle of the book reflects that it deals with the system of Indian taxation. So it doesn't cover one topic. And I'm sure that as you will go through the book, the kind of judicial pronouncements which have been given, the way they critically they have been analyzed, it is going to be of great help to all the professionals. Second thing which I stated was that we thought that we'll have a look at the author's credentials. And let me tell you that he's a fellow chartered accountant and educated at University of Delhi, certificate holder of comparative tax policy and administrative program of Harvard Kennedy School. He has been consistently adjudged over the year as one of the leading tax experts in Asia Pacific region by Chambers and Partners Legal 500, Who is Who, Asia Law, leading lawyers. He has been identified among 40 leading Indian lawyers under 45. Asim was featured in the Week magazine's special encourage coverage on young lawyers and has been bestowed award Young Achiever Lawyer. His name finds mention in the 100 Legal Luminaries of India, published by LexisNexis. I'm sure that the kind of reach which he has, it's great, sir. I'm sure that with your experience, the book must have got enriched. Having said that, in fact, another point which I thought, which I will cover is that when we look at the title, sir, I'm on the title. This is again, look at the title. Look at the humility of the author. He says, finding straight line between twists and turns. Then he has imperfect. He is so clear in his vision that given the muddle and mad jungle world of Indian taxation system, right, you cannot find perfection anywhere. In fact, it reflects his humility. He's not saying that he will find a straight line. In a lighter vein, in fact, I find twists and turns, a straight line, twists and turns, curves, much more romantic than finding a straight line, sir. So I'm sure that in our Indian taxation system, you can only attempt to find a straight line, but very difficult to draw a straight line. I'm sure the book is going to come to that conclusion as we read it further. In fact, what actually happened? Having been students of taxation, I have been a student of taxation in mid-70s. I think the developments, whichever has happened, globalization combined with sweep of technology. Now there are no geographical boundaries. In fact, boundaries and geography has become the history, sir. We really do not know how these e-commerce companies, people working on cloud software, are working, from where they are working, where is the establishment, who is going to tax them, what way it is going to happen, I shift from one telecom system to another telecom country in another country when I travel. So this is a major complex transactions. All these challenges of globalization technology have been emerging in the international taxation. In fact, we were shocked when the transfer pricing thing brought into the domestic field as well. So these are all burning issues. So I actually congratulate the author for picking up these issues in a select manner and dealing with them. So I'm sure that it deals with the 15 topics in detail. I will read out the topics. Sorry, I can't remember the topics at all, but it is wonderful, you know. One of the first topic is multilateral instrument, base erosion and profit shifting, ushering a new international tax policy paradigm. BEPS, I think, hits at the nail, you know. Our taxation basis gets eroded completely, you know. How to actually deal with that? All governments are sovereign governments in trouble. The second topic is guiding light, GAR, general anti-avoidance regulations, activating government trackers, unearthing undisclosed foreign income, ways and means of exchanging information, the trapping cage of transfer pricing, curious case of tax withholding, the ever-shadowing permanent establishment, capital gains implications and exemptions. The list does not end there. The famous Vodafone episode, and I think by the time he would have finished his book and the kind of reversal it has been done, yeah. I'm sure that whether it is covered that adequately or not.
Yeah, we have done a stop press.
Stop press, wonderful. So it actually brings the updates to the book. Tax administration, I'm the learned people from the tax department are sitting there, they will appreciate the topic. That is how to rerouting administration. Instances of income characterization, fee for technical services is another great area. Inversion of digital tax, equalization levy and more. I think we have to learn all these terms very clearly and actually how to tax them in the equitable manner, because the public finance system is a growth of certain basic principles. Crusade against money laundering, prevention of money laundering at 2002. Goods and service tax, a much desirable, but an arduous road ahead. I think there, in fact, in the GST, I welcome that this was the greatest step taken by the Indian government to monetize the Indian economy, whatsoever one people may say. It got actually into so many of crutches and problems, that actually the whole impact has come down. It has become more complicated by some of the wrong policy decisions. Finally, he has touched on the COVID-19 impact. I actually am very happy to see this topic here to visualize that how this pandemic is going to change the way we live. What is going to be new normal? I think entire thing is going to become different. So I congratulate that when I look at the list of topics, I'm surely that it delights me in quite a measure. I was able to have a look at the foreword written by, I think, Justice Nariman.
Yes.
Justice Nariman. And I think it has been lauded by one of my old friends, G.S. Panu, now officiating president of the ITAT, or say some other justice, Ravindra Bhatt. And so it itself speaks that with kind of warmth, and they have written those forewords. And that speaks a lot, sir. In fact, I'm sure that to draw a straight line is really difficult in this. Finally, I think what made me more happy was, sir, that according to me, Asim Chawla, he wrote is the first two pages of introduction, 1.5 page to be very exact.
Right.
And then he signs that page on July 16, 2021. To my utter surprise, when he signed the introduction on July 16, 2021, sir, he writes under that July 16, 2021, Sangrant, Savan. Believe me, gentlemen, my heart jumped out. Why? I will tell you. This reflects the Indian culture, ethos, and value system. I will share it with all of you since you are all learned members. Because most of, I'm sure that you do not know how the history of the Institute has moved. And I'm an historian of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. I'm a perfect historian. G.P. Kaparia, the first president, in fact, you happen to read the history of the accountancy profession in India, not of the Institute, history of the accountancy profession in India, I repeat, because he has written the history from the Companies Act 1913. So another act came in 2013. So first Companies Act 1913 in India, he begins from there. But G.P. Kapari, as man he was, he has devoted 50 pages to the Indian Vedas and Sanskrit culturalization of the Indian accounting system. Great man. But that's not the end of it. When the G.P. Kapari closed the book on history of accountancy profession in India, you will be all, I think, pleasantly surprised to know he concludes the history with a couplet at the end. And sir, the couplet is not of any Urdu shayar. The couplet is of Swami Tulsidas from Ramayana. He writes as the last sentence that man was about 72, 73 years old. This book was released in 1972. But he writes that Mo sam deen na deen hit tun saman raghubir asu vichar raghuvansh mani harhu visham bhavir. मेरे से कोई छोटा आदमी नहीं है मांगने वाला और आपसे कोई बड़ा आदमी देने वाला नहीं है. रघुवंश मणि, क्या मुझे इन सब चीजों से आप भावभंवर से मुक्ति दिला सकते हो? He is looking for the moksh. So I was actually bored to that gentleman, the fellow who upheld the Indian culture and ethos. And sir, the same feeling actually snapped through me when I looked at Sangram Sawan. I think I heard these words after very, very long time in my this thing. So, sir, I think that you are holding the flagship, not only of the knowledge, professional knowledge, that is accounting, auditing, or taxation on the pinnacle of it. Sir, I also congratulate for holding the flagship of the Indian Sanatan Dharma. So, I congratulate you for having done such a wonderful job. I can go on and on since I've been so excited about the book, but I think I would like to stop it here and request, I think, Sunil to sit. Sanjay Sethiji, to say a few words.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am the least qualified person to speak at this August gathering. But before I start, I must express my deep gratitude to Shri Raj Chawlaji, to Kapoor sir, to Asim, my author, for having considered me appropriate to speak in your presence. So I will not take too much of your time, but just share a few personal thoughts about Asim, my journey with him, and a little bit about the book. Firstly, I think I'm truly honored. So once again, thank you so much for the opportunity. As a veteran publisher with about 40 years of vintage, such occasions are truly gratifying to us because the publisher feels extremely happy if the author is happy. And beyond that, if the gurus, seniors of the author, give you their blessings that the product is good, then I think our work is doubly successful. So thank you, sir, for those kind words. Many years ago, I used to head Wolters Kluwer CCH in India as the managing director. And I was also on the board of the company in Asia. Although I'm not even remotely related to the TAL area, which is tax accounting and legal, the division that I used to head in South Asia, I think I learned a lot of jargon during those years when I used to head the company. And during those years, I had the good privilege of meeting a lot of seasoned professionals in the area of tax, in the area of accounting, in the area of legal profession. And I used to wonder and thank God that I have not been a part of that profession because I realized it's continuous learning. And someone who left learning at the age of 23, I was deeply indebted to God Almighty not to have allowed me to get into this profession. But I realize that this profession demands a lot of dedication. It demands the tax accounting and the legal, when I say this profession. It demands continuous learning, continuous sharing. It's a profession which is ever young, which is what I learned during those years when I used to interact with some of the best brains, not just in India, but globally, being part of the management team of the company. And I think my memories come back very vividly when in 2017, if I'm not wrong,
yeah.
Aseem and I met on this book. And Sir just mentioned Tulsidas Ji's quote. I don't know how many years Tulsidas Ji took to write that great Ramayana, or how many years Ved Vyasa Ji took to write the great Mahabharata. But I can tell you this gentleman took 5 years to write this book. So from 2017 till 2021, this gentleman has been working extremely hard, which speaks volumes about his dedication to the profession. And more than me, I think you would all realize, unless he had put in that heart and soul in the work, I'm sure all of you, sir, senior members of the fraternity, would not have been here to give him that love, affection, and encouragement. So that's what I feel. Sir was very kind to share a few topics. I just mentioned that, you know, we learned jargon as a management person in the TAL space, only to be able to communicate with people such as yourselves. That's about all. I really do not know, or didn't know for many years, what the full form of GAR is, or what the full form of many of the other terminologies that you use so often. However, going beyond that, while working on the book with him, and we do work with a lot of seasoned professionals, even after I left the company and I decided to open my own company, as publishers, we realize two things. I started my career as a sales representative. I used to sell books for Tata McGraw-Hill in my first job for the first 5 years. And my first sales manager was a professor of botany, Dr. Subramaniam, the later managing director of Tata McGraw-Hill in India. He taught us only one thing: never teach a teacher. So whenever we used to take the books to professors, we used to give them the book, and we used to avoid teaching them what was inside the book, because that was the most dangerous thing to do if they're a professor of any particular subject in which we were not educated, or even if we were educated, would ask us a question, we would be in very, very serious trouble. So what we used to do was to show them the back matter, to show them the preface, show them the marketing material, and to show them the list of contents and say, aap ye kitab rakhiye, isko padhiye, and I'm sure you will know more than I would ever be able to. So taking that advice, which I got 40 years ago from my first sales manager, I will not venture into the areas of you professionals and talk anything about the book. I think his heart and soul has gone into developing the book. At a personal level, I must also confess and add, I only wish this book had come 3 or 5 months earlier. It's with deep regret that I say this. Aseem lost his mother in the corona period in May.
Yeah.
He lost his mother-in-law 2 months after that. And knowing him for so many years, I feel I feel terrible, actually, that I wish we had all worked harder to be able to bring this book into light where his mother and mother-in-law could have seen it. But I think I can assure him, we have done in the past, that wherever those two noble ladies are, they would be blessing you, Aseem. And your hard work and dedication is something that you have imbibed from them. So without taking too much of your time, ladies and gentlemen, I wish to thank all of you for this honor. I'm deeply indebted. And again, without even attempting to talk about the book, I leave it to professionals and all of you to have a look. Go through the book, go through the contents, go through the back matter, and do make your own assessments on how I'm sure he's done the great job. And if there are any errors, I think we should, as publishers, own those errors, because we don't understand the subject. At the same time, I would like to thank you for your participation. The book is available outside. And I think there is a special discount. So if any of you wish to buy a copy, feel free to do that. Once again, thank you so much for everything. Very grateful to all of you.
You better stand.
Thank you, Kapoor Saab. It's very moving and humbling. And thank you, Sanjay Bhaiya, as we all affectionately call you. And thank you, Sunil Ji, for allowing us to share or use your Apple. And I am just thinking with my bright team sitting here that whether it is right to use or use, and whether it will result in some withholding tax of using your hardware. So I'm not very sure what are the tax consequences of it, but if it is without consideration, I'm sure there should not be any withholding. Maybe Bansal Saab can help in blessing that. There is no consideration unless you impute a consideration. But we are unrelated parties, so I don't think you will impute a consideration. So today is a great day for the Webathon series. Mr. Arora's first name alike, Garg Saab, Mr. Sunil Garg, Bansal Saab, and Baldev Ji, and all the senior members from the fraternity and from the revenue have championed this this great journey of walking through the 298 provisions of the Act. As we always say, the best is yet to come. I mean, not to take away the arduous hard work. I mean, all of you have contributed, the great first couple here standing, Himanshu Bhai, and all those who are here. And forgive me if I'm not being able to acknowledge, I must thank the great vision to walk this journey. I think it's very unique. I don't see any parallel of this, but at the same time, I think this is a great beginning. And as things progress, we can always improvise and improve upon. We have 7 more sessions coming, couple of them on international taxation, digital economy. We have session on Black Money Act, which is very close to Ashish's heart. Manu has done exceedingly well on interpretation of statutes, and of course, so we have 7 more sessions. So picture abhi baki hai. As far as the book is concerned, I think Sanjay Bhaiya made it a little more somber for me. COVID has been a period where all of us were tested. Now, yesterday I was, or rather day before yesterday and yesterday, I was asked to explain the book in one sentence. So I, and this is about 670 plus pages. So I said, well, it's a narrative. If you want to walk through the years from 2011-12 up until 2021, then it's a great narrative. Of course, it's not fiction, but it's a great narrative. The world, according to me, changed post Lehman, which is 2008-09, when we had the global financial crisis. And suddenly the way in which people were looking at things got changed. And in 2012 came the great retrospective amendment on, and that was legislated on 28th of May 2012. And on 10th and 11th of May, those of you watch very closely the parliamentary debates, the then finance minister said that India will not eat lizards if we don't get foreign direct investment. And this is on record of the proceedings. So this was a statement made in the upper house. And of course, while the book was under publication, Sanjay Bhaiya was very kind enough to agree to our request to do a stop press to bring the first week of August, when the present government said, okay, we pull back. So we had to do a stop press on that. After 2012, I think the landmark years, which relatively have not gone unnoticed but put together can be noticed, is 2016-17. You had demonetization, you had introduction of GST,
You had reinvigoration of Benami law. You had introduction of Black Money Act. You had introduction of power of arrest in FEMA. You had amendments in FEMA whereby the central government took away from the RBI the rules with regard to equity, and therefore and for debt still RBI is empowered to frame rules. And then of course you had contemporaneous amendments in PMLA. So I think that's a very big change. And in my lectures which I do for Institute of Chartered Accountants of India on money laundering, I always say, insofar as Indians' legal landscape on fiscal economic laws 2016-17 and the consequential amendments in Income Tax Act also which came through, parallelly the world was running on a very fast adrenaline of introduction of BEPS, which led into the mutation, is not a very happy word, and you found in 2019 introduction of multilateral instrument. Of course, now the world will again change. You will have two kinds of world, pre and post COVID. So 2020 was COVID, and the very recent warnings by many multilateral agencies that not only COVID, you have to look at the weather and the whole aspect of sustainability, and you have sustainable development goals, and whether the great mission of United Nations to have a poverty-free world by 2030, whether that will get actualized, and that entirely depends upon the economic policies of the nations and the world as a whole. Well, without much ado, I know we are running behind time maybe, and I'll pretty much conclude by saying that I'm grateful to the fraternity, very grateful to Kapoor Saab for his benevolent review, grateful to everybody who's contributed this. By no means I can claim the credit. Yes, follies are mine. Grateful to the legal luminaries who have blessed the book with their foreword and testimonials, which have come from almost four continents. About four continents, if I can say it with all authority of my command. Our Australian friend was on family way. Apart from that, pretty much we've got from Europe, Latin America, North America, Africa, Asia, and both from academia as well as from practicing community, UAE. So pretty much from every part of the world, people have been able to do some quick review within the Indian fraternity. We've been very fortunate. The team has worked very hard. Some of them are sitting here with me. So it's a holistic view, and your encouragements are more than welcome. I think with this, Garg Saab, I think we're done.
Yeah.
And I am grateful to the great forum and hope that you continue with the remaining seven sessions and enjoy your today's evening. Thank you very much.
Friends, with this, we move on to the last part of the session. In fact, frankly speaking, the enthusiasm with which I've seen in the, particularly after the onset of pandemics in the, since mid of March, this Raj Chawlaji, along with his associates, has been going on and on. And in fact, we did cover lot of topics, large number of topics, followed by this webathon on decoding of the income tax law. And as CMG informed that now they're going to start with the series on international taxation. It's a very pragmatic thing. Not only that, I think we did organize lectures on spiritual yoga and meditation. And in fact, a free vaccination camp was also organized for the CA members and students with the help of our local MP, Shri Gautam Gambhir. So as I begin, and I will request Shri IP Bansalji to come on the dais. And IP Bansalji, please. Friends, I think I'm always, actually these days I don't take enough lectures. And frankly speaking, I must tell it, share it with you. I have stopped taking any lecture generally for the members. I only take lecture for the students nowadays. So I've shifted my stand to that way. But since I'm talking to such an respected members, and I think when I'm going to read this last few lines written by G.P. Kapadia, it must excite you. It must generate vigor in you. It must enforce you and meditate yourself that where does this profession stands today? When the gentleman wrote his book and closed the book with this last few lines which he wrote, and then he wrote, sir, Tulsidas Ramayana's last couplet. I'm highly indebted to that man whenever I read it again and again. In the last page, he wrote, the task stands accomplished. Nay, it has begun. It has just begun. The task stands accomplished. No, it has just begun. It is not a question of what stands achieved. It's a question of what still remains to be done. And am I not a creature of destiny, a mere instrument for his purpose? Look at the gentleman's feelings for the Indian Vedic culture, you know. A mere instrument, hamesha kehte hain nimit matra hain. Aur mera ye manna hai, if after this pandemic, which we could never imagine, and I think it should never come, sir, even the next 100 years, I think if it can't teach us the humility, I think we cannot teach anything in the rest of our lives. A mere instrument for his purpose. My assignment. Now, see, please remember, see, when I repeat this each sentence, I do not know how much I am able to make an impact on each chartered accountant member of this profession, you know, and what do they think and what do they talk and what do they want to achieve. This should have become the guiding goals, that this should have been written in the golden words outside the institute, you know. In fact, I had made a request that history book should be given to free. In fact, I was the author of the second volume of the history of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. So I know all ins and outs. My assignment, I see as one of duty. Fruits whereof I cannot and do not seek. We have to do our work. Gita Shlok. When the fruits will come, nobody knows. We are living in an uncertain future. And look at the way he visualized it. My assignment I see as a duty. Fruits whereof I cannot and do not seek. That has to be the intention. That has to be the spirit, you know, with humility and full dedication. I salute my institute. I adore my profession. Hats off to that first president, G.P. Kapadia. When he writes this book, the book is released in 1972. He had taken 10 years to write this book. And the way he concludes the whole thing, I'm sure there is a great message for everybody. So when we sit here and when we talk of felicitation, when we talk of expressing gratitude to all of you, there has to be feeling has to be generated. How the professional, because the profession is composed of the all sum total of all individuals. Each individual does matter. And on the top of it, I'm very sure that no profession, no individual can work in a vacuum. And we are an integral part of the society. Being that integral part, we can't work in a vacuum. We are part of the profession. How actually we deal with ourselves as a professional duty, how do we actually look at the thing, I think makes a lot of difference. Friends, with this, I think I will, IP Bansalji is here. And I think I will request now our dear friend, one of my very old friends, C.A. Rajesh Agarwal. Please, Rajesh ji, come here. Very dynamic fellow. He had been the past secretary and treasurer of NIRC, along with, I think, Chawla ji's tenure, he was there. Yes, yes. So he's a very dynamic fellow. And actually, my problem is that I feel that everybody knows me. I'm not able to. He's the person who's risen from the ground. Today he's with us. So I've requested him to come forward and help us in felicitating and expressing our gratitude to all those people who have been attached with the Northern Indian Association of Chartered Accountants. Thank you, friends. So I think now, Sunil ji, I think you can tell us that how to go about, whom to invite. So IP Bansal ji is here. Thank you, Kapoor Saab.
It is a very difficult to speak after the Kapoor Sahib, a very, very learned speaker. Just because I am the listener, not a speaker. But as the Kapoor Sahib ordered me to do the formalities of this thing, and the time has come, the most excited event of Babathan series to honor our very, very learned, experienced and star speaker of this series. Because without their efforts and hard working, it was not possible to even conceptualize this series. I must congratulate Raj Chawla ji to conceptualize, to have this series. I also congratulate Sunil Garg ji for holding this very, very big. It started from 16 June today, 16 June and onward to till today, to organize each and every webinar on such a big crowds and honor all these things. And in this list, I first of all request IP Bansal ji, kind Girish ji has started this Babathan series. I will say only few lines about him. Just like a Mahabharata start from Krishna and end with the Krishna. So I think it that direct text start with him and ends also with him. So I request all of you, please give him a big round of applause. And in the series of this, our very, very learned parts president, C.A. Amarjit Chopra ji, is also not available here due to some urgent work or corona also. And he is the mother of all accounting standard. So without accounting standard, it was not possible a chartered accountant to complete even the audit. I remember the old days when invited him in the Pusa Road CP study circle as a speaker. He always emphasis on to learn the accounting standard and apply the accounting standard in their audit. I also accept it. Whosoever chartered accountant apply, learn the accounting standard in audit, he is from the DC, Disciplinary Action Institute. So today there is a lot of disciplinary action against the chartered accountant. So Chopra ji, all credit go to Chopra ji. We also congratulate him and honor him.
I think thank you, Rajiv ji. I will only add, because I taught accounting standards for only 3 years in my life. And the slogan of my teaching accounting standard was, in 2002, there was a World Cup cricket. The Coke used to sell as eat cricket, sleep cricket, drink Coca-Cola. And the slogan which has given to the membership at that time was, eat accounting standards, drink accounting standard, even sleep with accounting standards. Thank you.